Hey guys, this is May. And today, I take you behind the scenes. Because I had so many people asking me, like, what do you really mean when you tell your audience that you are doing calculations or that you are preparing your predictions? And I think a lot of people are very curious, like, what really does an astrologer do, like, day in, day out, especially when I'm, like, preparing my predictions for a webinar? So, I'm just going to actually show you what I do. And you also see that today I'm seated like at this balcony, and this is actually where I work every day. I get all my calculations done here. And actually, I don't know if you can tell, but today is kind of like a rainy day. And if you kind of can see in the background, I have a wonderful view from this balcony, which is like a real perk of my workplace. Having said that, you know, one thing that I felt was quite important for me. In fact, throughout the whole of last year when I was working on predictions sitting here, is that this view, besides being just beautiful and like enjoyable, keeps me focused on the fact that we need to take a very, very broad perspective. Like when I'm doing a prediction, it's quite clear to me that I'm not just talking to like one person or one industry. Whatever it is that I uncover is affecting the whole of Singapore, and in fact, thinking about what it does to humanity. Okay, so anyway, that's just me, okay? So let me just show you what I actually do. I work very simple. It's like I just need chair, table, and just a laptop. And this thing is called ephemeris. So lots of people don't know this. Of course, there are digital versions available, but I'm a bit old-fashioned lah. Okay, so if you don't really know what ephemeris looks like, right? It looks something like I open it. Like my mentor calls this like a telephone directory. So it's a very boring one. Inside, it's all like every page is like this. You know, so it's just a listing of actual planetary positions on any given day of like, this is like a 100 year, 1950 to 2050. So I use this to sort of a reference. It's also useful for looking at like planetary patterns. And so this one I can show you later. I have these things, which is what I call cheat sheets for certain planetary placements where I just simply write them down on index cards so that I don't have to keep looking for the correct page. You know, I just write down all the essential information. So I actually use this a lot when I'm doing my predictions. So for example, some things that so just to give you a bit of context as to so today I'm actually like for real getting started on some calculations that I'm doing, not for Singapore and for USA, because I've done those already. In fact, today I'm putting a little bit of work for India and China, because I am doing some talks for a few corporate type companies, and it seems that these countries are what they're interested in. So now I have to go and do the work for India and China. So just as a sense of what I'm going to do, it looks something like this. Okay, so that's a software that I work with. So this software is known as Solarfire, and which is pretty nice because in times past, astrologers would have to do chart calculations from scratch. It's like, because last time don't have computer. So you literally had to, and you didn't have the luxury of things like that, you know. So traditionally, astrologers would have to actually keep their own records of where the planets were and to actually calculate for, say, if I was looking at New Delhi or Calcutta in India, and then to center the chart on that specific placement. So one of the things that I'm going to show you is this I'm going to open. This is the chart for India, and based on their Independence Day. So some things that people sometimes ask me is like, okay, human have birth chart, right? That's the time and the moment you were born. How in the world do you decide the birth time of a country? So famously for Singapore's case, I have set it for the moment it was announced on our local radio that we now declare Singapore an independent country. This is based on a speech that was written by Lee Kuan Yew himself that was broadcast on the radio. And that happened exactly at 10 a.m. In the morning. This is, that's why, you know, that's the chart I've been using. So in fact, for a country, we think of who or what the country is right now, the identity that they have and when it was started. So for example, in China and India, these are countries with thousands of years of history, at least. And so at what point do we decide that this is their birthday or their birth, you know, time? We want to be as accurate as possible. So for example, for India, I've written here, 15th of August, 1947. And it stated here 001 a.m. Right, in New Delhi, India. Now, how did I decide on this? Because if we think of the modern India, if you go to someone who lives in India right now, their Independence Day is the India that they have today, not like during the old Maharaja times, you know? So it's like, so if I go to Wikipedia, for example, let me just find this. Okay, so if you look, I Googled here for India's Independence Day, and it's listed here that it is 15th of August 1947, and this marks the day that they celebrated their independence from the United Kingdom. Okay, so of course, when it comes down to time, I mean, there are directories that astrologers tend to use. So the good news is some astrologers have done their work on the chart already. So sometimes the time is set for the time that the treaty is signed, sometimes it's set for the time their independence is declared to the whole country. It depends. And now what this means is that when I'm not 100% sure that this chart or this 0001 is the correct time, what this means is that when I do country's chart, I have to do the extra step of verifying the birth time. So before I even start doing predictions, I have to first look at events that have happened in the past. So if it corresponds exactly to the chart that I see on the screen right now, then I know that this 0001 is a reliable time. Otherwise, maybe it's wrong, you know? Like whoever said that it's at the very first minute of the day, then you declare your independence, right? So so some of the things that I've done, okay, so as you can see here, I have a Wikipedia article for the COVID-19 pandemic in India. So that was basically all the events that happened in 2020 when it comes to the COVID crisis for India. Like for example, when was the first case registered? So for example, the country of India must have experienced like, oh shit, we have this problem. So this will happen the first day someone is a confirmed case. And that doesn't mean that's the day the case came into India, because we won't know when it came into India. We just know this is the time that everyone knows, okay, now COVID is in our country. So it says here that on the 12th of January, okay, so WHO confirmed novel coronavirus is a thing in Wuhan, right? But that it is in Wuhan, it's not India's problem yet. It's still, you know, Wuhan virus, right? And it says here that on 30th of January, India reported its first case of COVID-19. So what I typically do is I open something like, so I have like a notepad open here, and I actually collect a lot of these events that actually happen with as close to the exact date as possible. So 30th Jan, I'll type here 2020. I might make a note here like, you know, first COVID case. So later, when I go back and check into my ephemeris, based on this specific chart, at this specific time, does it actually describe the first case of COVID-19? Now, if it does, then okay, one tick. Then I have to keep going for multiple activities. And frankly, I'm just showing you the COVID-19 one right now because that's the most like relevant one, right? But I could go further back, like if there are political upheavals, say 4 or 5 years ago, or maybe 10 years ago, something happened. I'll pick a smattering of events that I match it to make sure that this chart is confirmed correct, then I do prediction. So all this is before I even start any kind of prediction work. Yeah, so it's like, yeah, rose to 3 cases, and usually I'm looking for, say, very major events. The first COVID case, the day India locked down, or it could be the day that India announced that they are in emergency state, for example. So I'm looking for things that will affect every single person in India. Okay, so yeah, basically, yeah, this Wikipedia is very useful, okay? So for example, now I'm just going to proceed. I have not verified the India chart, and I'm not going to do it on camera because it will take me hours, sometimes days. So I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to pretend that this chart is correct, okay? So if you're watching this video, I wouldn't take this time as being correct yet because I haven't verified, yeah? Okay, so assuming this is correct, some of the interesting things that people are concerned about is, okay, is illness going to be a big problem in India? So I would focus some of my attention here on the number 6 house, because that's where we are looking for traces of illnesses or sickness. And also a lot of the people who are asking about India are doing business with India. So they are very interested to know if there are going to be disruptions. Also small things like if you have transport services throughout India. just because you have COVID doesn't mean the trains stop working, for example. But if I see a lot of disruptions to, say, transport indicators in India, then it could cause problems that are beyond COVID, for example. Yeah, so let's just stick with the sixth house first for illnesses. There are, you know, a couple, two or three things here. One is a planet, one is Chiron. So I'm looking for if any of these moving planets start to affect the things that are in the sixth house, and how they affect will start to give me clues as to what is happening in India. Now, in this case, so for example, at any one time, for example, if I look at, say, the planet Pluto, which tends to create crises in a country, that's usually where I start. So in this particular chart, Pluto would be, this year in 2021, it is sort of moving between 24 to 26 degrees Capricorn. So this little olive sign here is the sign of Capricorn. And I have, where my cursor is, is kind of like where Pluto is sort of hanging out. Then I'm searching in the chart to see if at this position, does it affect anything? And yeah, so good news is India doesn't seem to get any issues with Pluto this entire year, assuming this chart is correct. So I don't see anything here. And the other planet is things like Neptune. I start with the major planet. So Neptune is sort of hanging out here between 20 to 23 degrees. So that's where it is. I also, let me see, I don't really see an immediate connection except for a quincunx with the sun. So it's a very technical thing, right? Okay, so what I actually do is I also make notes, like for example, I have the Neptune, quincunx, the sun, and you know, I could go on, but this is very boring for people who actually don't know astrology. So how is it that I know that Pluto is hanging out sort of between this period? Is because like my cheat sheet here kind of tells me like, okay, so Pluto is at 24 degrees between, say, February 2020 to November 2021. But that's November 2021, which is this year, which means still in effect, right? So I do know that when things are in effect, so I don't know if you can see my cheat sheet, but you can see all these like cancellations. It's because my cheat sheet, as you can see, is very old and dirty. I have kept these cheat sheets for years. Some of these planetary positions will stay there for like 2 years, 3 years. And generally speaking, that's important, right? For a country, things like, for example, if the stock market gets affected, if health issues are affected, it's not always. In fact, most of you realize that COVID is not like, you know, it hits, then 2 months later, it disappears. It's not so simple. The implications are far reaching. So some of these planets that stay in the same position for a long time, I want to track them. So when I look at something like India's chart, and because Pluto is sort of hanging out here, one of the things that I noticed for 2022 is that it will make an opposition 27 degrees here. It will hit the opposition to 27 degrees by sometime next year. So in fact, I might go to my notepad and I might make a note here, say Pluto opposite the moon. And it's not enough for me to just say this. Most of the time, I need to have the date as well. So, I mean, I won't show this on my cheat sheet now, but this is exactly what an astrologer do. So I flip into my book, and the reason why I know it's 2022 is because I work with charts every day, and I know it doesn't hit in 2021. So then, logically speaking, it's 2022. My Femaris tells me that it hits 27 degrees on the 3rd of February 2022. So I might make a note here. Okay, 3rd of February 2022. Put that to the next line so that it's clearer. And of course, I want to know how long this lasts. Okay, so flipping into my book. Okay, wow, this is going to be very long. And this one's going to last all the way until the 1st of November 2023. So from February 22 to November 2023 is almost 2 years. So whatever is this issue that's going to show up, okay, I'm just going to do this short so that, you know, just to show everybody what I actually do. So if you see from my screen here, just putting in this date here, yeah, it looks like 2223, right? But one is beginning of the year, one is end of the year, so it's almost 2 years here, right? So what does this really mean? Now, Pluto in the ninth house, so by the way, before I do this interpretation, just so you know, this is not a prediction. I'm doing this on a hypothetical chart because I have not verified this India chart yet. Okay, so everything I say here can be wrong. I have not verified this chart here. I'm just showing you an example. So if Pluto's in the ninth, some of the issues that show up could be things like broadcasting. But you know, nowadays no one looks at broadcasting. We could be looking at things like Facebook or Instagram. Nowadays, those things are not considered technology really. They're considered ways in which ideas are being broadcasted, shared. Sometimes it's things like politics, beliefs, people disagreeing with stuff. And if it's opposite the moon, I mean, in a country's chart, like it could be some emotions being stirred up. People are just feeling quite emo lah in general. But with this placement, in the first place, if this chart is accurate, then India is always going to be a country that is very focused on thought, thinking, information, like, you know, digging into information, verifying whether it's correct or not. And this is one of the reasons why before an astrologer even starts with prediction, verifying the chart also means that I get to know the country first. Just, it's the same way as when I do a human person's chart. I don't just jump into your prediction and say, oh, this year's going to be bad because you lose your job or whatever. But because sometimes the chart tells me if somebody is very freedom-oriented, you know, they are not really the hold on to a job kind. Sometimes losing their job, right, is taken as a yes by that person, you see. So even the same thing happens in countries. Sometimes things happen that make countries quite comfortable. Now, if this chart is accurate, the crisis may not come across as badly to some people because India loves to have discourse. Now, if this chart is accurate, then the whole everybody has an opinion, then everybody wants to do research and fact-finding, fact-verification. It's a natural thing based on this chart. And therefore, well, some people are going to be in heaven next year because there's so much to uncover and investigate. But will it be disruptive? Possibly. Might it uncover, say, with this placement, Pluto opposite Moon, might it uncover some uncomfortable truths? Some people like not happy with what they've discovered. Yeah, all possible. Okay, so this is kind of what I do. And I usually come up with a whole list of all these calculations. So I have these up. It can come up to like a really long list. Like my notepad can just be like really be filled up completely with all of these. And sometimes what I do is I sometimes transfer it into a Microsoft Word document, as what you can see on my screen right now. Because once I start to see certain patterns showing up, and actually when you watch my webinars, you realize that when I do the country predictions, I tend to put them into categories. So for example, I might have one, say maybe health issues. Right, so as I'm typing health issues, then I might put down all the relevant indications that I see that may relate to health issues so that I can tell if I see a lot of overlaps, for example, I'm like, okay, this period is going to be bad. Like, yeah, people are going to fill up hospitals, for example. Or if things start to clear up and it seems that, okay, after this like terrible period, after that people seem to get better, like, oh, there's not much activity, then I know that there's a good chance that things can improve. So it's like, I could like, you know, of course in this case, that's not really, I could have say Saturn opposite Pluto, you know, or, so these are astrological language, right? So if I put here like rule six house or whatever I'm writing here, yep. So I collect, I categorize them. There can be health issues. I can have like, say, political discourse, for example. I give them very broad categories. There can even be, say, transport disruptions. I'm making this up, guys. This is not a prediction, okay? I'm just making stuff up. It can even be, say, like opening up of trade, for example. So these are categories, and my job is to go and search, and are there enough indicators happening in the chart to tell me where I see a story somewhere? One of my students once said, like, your webinars are like storytelling. You sort of say, oh, by this time, this thing rises, and after that, two or three things are happening at the same time. So they sort of converge, and either they get into each other's way, make things worse, make things better, they compensate. So these are issues, ways in which people allow the story to play out. And so once each category is going to have its all the dates, all the relevant stuff there, and I also use Excel sheets. So for example, I might start with say January, February, March. So it's like, you know, it's very tedious work. We could make this simple with a lot of software, but I like doing this in a more sort of like a tedious kind of way because it allowed in filling up the boxes, that's how I see the pattern. And so, for example, if I see something is happening, I'm making this up, from say February to November, then I could sort of like just sort of highlight this. Maybe it's from 8 to, I don't know, like say 11 of November, for example. So that as I am putting these things out onto my screen, I can start to see if there's overlap. Say if something starts from say March until say May the next year. So I'm just gonna highlight this. So I fill this in like April, May. Then even if this is like, I don't know, 23rd of April, and this is, depending on what I see in my ephemeris, this could be 17th of May or whatever. But you see there's an overlap period here where this April to November, and that's how I know that if multiple things are stacking up at the same time and if they are causing stress, and which is why in a hypothetical nation, I could be, oh, like COVID cases are up, transport system is down. And then, and if I see that there are financial difficulties or in specific industries, of course, logically speaking, when a lot of tension issues are happening at the same time, we could start to draw connections. And what my job would be is I go past into the future. So for example, if say we look at Hong Kong or whatever, and we see say some indications of like say uprising, like they had the issue say about 1-2 years ago, right? And if we see like transport systems down, so you may recall like when they had the student uprising, the airports were on lockdown, you know, the planes couldn't fly, they even took over train stations and all. So my job is to determine, are the two incidents connected to each other? As in, is it because student uprising caused the system to break down, or is it the other way around? It could be that the system break down, then all the students angry. It could be like that too. Or they could be totally separate incidents with no relation to each other. And this is where the research gets really, really hard because I go back in time. And this particular book takes me all the way back to 1950. I also have ephemeris that go back to like back to say even 100 years. It's one of the reasons why when you watch my webinars, I actually trace the history of democracy. I trace the history of like revolutions. And if I see a pattern, I will present it. So it's like, if I want to look at student uprisings, then I search for, say, if I'm looking at Hong Kong or India, if people are unhappy or resentful about something, then I look for in the chart to see, is there an indicator that shows this behavior? And then I go back to, when was the last time this happened? Then I say, oh, maybe it's like, I'm making this up, like maybe 1932 this happened. But you know, I wasn't there in 1932. So now I have to go and do my research, right? Did something similar happen in 1932, right? So if I notice that, oh, you know, there's a series of railway riots in 1932, I'm like, okay, I'm starting to see a pattern here. And I want to know how that issue showed up. And then I do detailed calculations for 1932 to see exactly how did the train riots happen, if they happened. Then I correlate them to today's time and for me to be able to piece the story together. So guys, I mean, what I'm showing you from today's little behind the scenes thing, right? I went into a bit more detail. It's, I think it answers quite a bit of questions as to why this kind of prediction is not something like, you know, hey May, look at my face and do you think like, what's 2021 going to be like for me? But I don't know. I have to sit down and actually, you know, do this work and if to get to the level of detail. Some people have asked, how come you can be confident? How come you dare to put dates on a PowerPoint slide and put it on a webinar? It's because, guys, I've mined that data over and over again. So basically, I've run it through like a, what I call a historical simulator. So that means if I know that the last 5 times it happened, it was like this, there's a very good chance that if it happens again, good chance I'm correct. And it's one of the reasons why for these predictions, when it comes, I don't know about other kinds, but Western astrology is not about knowing the future. It's very boring and very tedious going through numbers and dates and historical events over and over and over and over again. And it's also one of the reasons why some people ask me, well, we think what you do is fascinating, like why don't you teach more people to do predictions? I do teach students this. Well, I think it's quite safe to say that most people are not willing to put in this amount of work. So the reality is, if most people want to like maybe just buy this and maybe buy a software, and then maybe if I key in a few dates, then well, I will know what happened. No, it doesn't work that way. It really doesn't. So it's yeah, I mean, you can buy the book, but this doesn't tell you what happens, you know? And yeah, so it's the difficulty here is, I think it's the expectation. But here's the truth. Do I enjoy this? Actually, yes lah. I mean, not many people know this, but I'm very geeky one. So I really like putting numbers and things together. I like seeing the story come together. And personally, what I really enjoy from this process is an understanding of humanity. Because when I do any kind of prediction, I go back so long in history, especially if I know I'm going to be presenting this to an audience or on a webinar, that I start to understand how humans operate. Why the same pattern repeats itself over and over again? Which part of the psyche does it come from? As far as I'm concerned, this is like, you want to call this my hobby, I guess it is lah. And if it helps some people to do your planning, then good for you. And yeah, but this is the work that I do. So generally speaking, like how long would I take to prepare, say, one country's prediction in that sense? Verifying the birth time, the start time by itself can take me anywhere from just an hour or so, 2 hours, to potentially days of verification if the birth time, the time is very contaminated. Right? So if whatever I can find on astrologers' database is accurate, then very fast. You know, I just need to confirm with a couple of events, after that I'm satisfied. Yeah, so it can take days just to verify a birth time. Doing the actual sort of like a predictive portion, like grabbing all these numbers, dates, and sticking them together, the first draft usually takes me maybe about 2, maybe 3 hours. And yeah, but what becomes very difficult is the interpretation. So it's like you can have a whole bunch of all these things going on, like is it a riot? Is it like a bountiful harvest in their farming community? That one can take me up to a week of non-stop research just to verify. And then after that, I start to think about how to present it in a way that a non-astrologer can understand. So I condense all of that into maybe like the 5 or 6 PowerPoint slides that you see on a webinar. So I guess that's kind of what I have to show you for today. And please leave a comment, you know, tell me if, do you actually want to know the results of what I'm calculating when I'm done with it? And also, I mean, if I do more behind the scenes videos, what else do you really want to know about or to see me doing? Okay, so leave your comments in the box below, and I will see you guys in my next video.